Hello and welcome to News Laundry Live. It's results day. There's a lot of madness all over television news channels. Trends are coming by the minute. So we are going to do a little bit of something different from what all TV channels are going to do. We're not going to shout or scream, but soberly sit and analyze and look at the trends. I have with me a wonderful panel of reporters and journalists. I'll introduce them before I update you a little bit on the trends. Vrinda Gopinath, a seasoned journalist. She's worked with Indian Express, Pioneer, Mail Today. Am I missing out anything else? No. And she covered Uttar Pradesh for News Laundry. Many of you would have read her reports and opinion pieces on our website. She's given us some fabulous insights, so hopefully we'll talk a lot about that. We have with us Anumeha Yadav. She's an independent journalist. She's previously worked with Scroll and Indian Express and Hindu, and she covers labor and policy. That's her forte. She's covered Jharkhand for us and Gujarat for us. Some really fabulous stories. We got a lot of great feedback on those. And the empty chair is for Neha Dixit, who's late. She's going to join us in the next 15 minutes. She also did a story for us from Madhya Pradesh. Just to update you a little bit on the trends, I'm going to talk about the trends from 11:41 a.m. The BJP is leading with 328, and the Congress is at 103. So it's a very clear sort of BJP comeback. The numbers are still not certain. They could fluctuate because it's just 12 o'clock right now. Yeah, it's around 12. So I think we'll have to wait till 3, 4 o'clock before we really know what the numbers are. But it seems like NDA is likely to come back very comfortably. UP is very exciting, Vrinda. And you were traveling there.
Well, what's really surprising is that the Mahagathbandhan, which was supposed to have been doing extremely well, seems to be not doing so well.
Yeah.
If you look, I'm not sure what the numbers are yet, but they seem to be creeping up, which is not a bad sign. Because by sheer caste arithmetic, it should have worked wonderfully for them. Even though everybody says that the Congress could cut into their votes in many places, which the Congress has, like say in Saharanpur and two, three other places. But they also, the Congress has worked to cut the BJP's votes. In a lot of constituencies, which I showed in my story last time.
Yeah.
So in that sense, we still have to see how it plays out. But what they were expecting, a sweep for the Gathbandhan, that seemed to be
That's not happening. And in fact, BJP seems poised quite well. But I want to ask you one thing. I mean, a lot of the television channels at least are now talking about how this is a tsunami. It's like a wave for Modi, a second wave. In your travels, when you spoke to people voting, how important was the Modi factor?
Well, to be what one found out in UP, for instance, is that it was going purely by caste. I mean, there was nothing else that defined this election in Uttar Pradesh was caste. So if you had, so that's exactly what Samajwadi Party and BSP were representing, and the BJP for the so-called upper caste. So there was a bit of a kind of confusion among the Brahmins in certain places, because when the Congress came and they, you know, because they are pretty upset with the BJP because of Yogi Adityanath,
who
was seen as this Thakur leader who was, you know, only promoting the Thakurs in the bureaucracy, in a lot, and the Brahmins, which are only like barely 12% of the vote, but wield, it's not a power and influence that they wield is not at all commiserate with what their vote bank.
So, but Modi, because if
so, there was no Modi wave. No. To tell you,
you didn't.
There was no Modi wave. It was purely caste. People were deciding. So it was the SP, BSP were clearly caste based. The BJP, of course, and the Congress kind of came in between. And everybody was going to vote tactically to see whether their party would come tops.
Anumeya, someone who's been covering agrarian distress, a lot of your stories also spoke of rural distress. And in fact, there were like certain instances where you've interviewed voters who were very fed up, who weren't really getting anything, but they still said that, okay, but hum BJP ko hi vote karenge, Modi ke liye wait karein. So, first question to you is, did you feel that Modi was a factor? Was it like an election where people felt, ki nahi, we want to vote for a prime minister? And how real is the rural distress in your assessment when you were traveling?
So Manisha, I traveled to Gujarat first and then to Jharkhand. And in these two states, one is Gujarat was one of the states where BJP got all where BJP got all 26 seats last time. And what was interesting was between then and now, there had been an assembly election where they had done slightly poorly in rural areas. So I was curious that this is one place where Congress and BJP are in a direct contest. And is Congress able to build on the dissatisfaction or is able to provide any alternative to people who are not happy with what's going on in those areas? So in Gujarat, I found a sharp contrast. In urban areas, there's definitely a very strong Modi factor. A lot of people I spoke to said that it's not even about the BJP. BJP may be, there is maybe some problem of corruption, etc. in that party. But Modi is a hero. He's a Gujarati. He's, you know, for sure, it's like some godlike phenomena in urban Gujarat.
In Delhi, like, all seven seats are going to BJP. Mm. And what we also got to hear a lot here is that MP jaisa bhi ho, Prime Minister hame.
Yeah.
So that's an urban thing.
Yeah, so urban areas, and then if you just go 100 kilometers out of the city, 150 kilometers, I travel to Gondal, Rajkot, Kutch, these areas, there is a lot of distress. So Gujarat has had two bad years of rains. This time, because of the drought, people have not been able to sow their winter crop. 2017, the BJP tried to buy crops at a higher price, with the result that the next year the prices went down. So there are several factors, and also in irrigation, they have been speaking of Narmada. They inaugurated Narmada as complete in September 2017, but the canals have not reached the farms. So there was a lot of anger, but there was a bit of this thing that somehow there wasn't a clear alternative or a, you know, I didn't sense them strongly saying that, yes, they are not, we are not happy with what's going on right now, but we see someone else offering something better. Mm-hmm. That definitely came across. I'll come to Jharkhand later if, you know.
Yeah. Yeah. In fact, one of your pieces from Gujarat with a professor who's kind of
interviewed,
watches,
Professor Ghansham.
Ghansham. And he said that, I thought it was very interesting because he seemed like he was not happy with the BJP, but he was very critical of the Congress, saying that you have just not been able to provide a counter imagination. Mm-hmm. Besides just, gali maroing to Modi, you're not really coming out with what, you want to offer.
Yeah, yeah. So Professor Ghansham Shah is a pretty senior, he's a very senior political scientist, and his analysis was this, that BJP for sure is continuing its campaign on communal caste and regional lines. In Gujarat, there's a strong pitch for son of the soil, that it's, a Gujarati as the party president, Gujarati as prime minister, so you must vote for a Gujarati. But when Congress is trying to counter it, they are not showing any strong conviction either. Mm. If you are sensing distress among workers and farmers, you are not able to strongly put forward something which will alter a structural change. Mm. That this 2,000 rupee, that cash transfer that's been made, most farmers, especially in Gujarat, who are middle-income farmers, 2,000 means very little. You can buy like fertilizer which will last you 1 month,
yeah,
or so on. But you are, they know it's not serious, it's not sincere, but you're not able to strongly critique that policy and offer something else. Even this Nyaya thing we all have seen, it's been very diluted, it came in very late, no one is very clear how this will be done, and they've not been able to put
really
it forward.
Communicated.
Or even this Chokidar thing he was pointing out, that, that you have not been able to strongly counter that narrative either, this, that okay, Chokidars have low wages, poor working conditions, have you been able to strongly counter that as well?
Chokidar Chor hai slogan, do you think it resonated with people? Like, was it something
Like I said, because it was such a caste pitched battle in Uttar Pradesh, the thing is that the Congress was barely there. So you didn't hear this Chokidar Chor hai because they were hardly there. Mm. But what was interesting was that whether it's rural, whether it is urban, like I said, because of almost became a bipolar contest, which is not a good thing because it always favors the BJP. Mm. That's why one of the things that the Congress kept saying is that we didn't want to be part of this Gathbandhan because it polarizes. Mm. So when you have a three-way contest and you kind of, and they said, we were soft peddling in very many constituencies, which was helping the Gathbandhan. So in that sense, yes, the Congress was barely there. But in terms of the Congress campaign, no.
But okay, so caste, of course, you've mentioned that it was a big factor. Like, I'm guessing everywhere else, maybe a little more in UP, but that is a reality of Indian politics. What are the issues? Like, what did you feel were the issues that people were thinking of? Like, was it jobs? Was it nationalism? Was it cow protection? Especially in UP, because it's,
So the Awara cow was like the biggest, the Awara guy was one of the thing in rural areas, for instance, because they were literally eating off, people's incomes. But how much has that rural distress kind of come in, which has either damaged the BJP or helped the Gathbandhan? We still can't say because we don't know what the vote percentages are.
Yeah.
But in terms of issues, I didn't hear nationalism at all. I mean, it was none of that.
Balakot.
Yeah. If you speak to the urban upper caste, it comes. If you speak to the urban or rural backwards and the Dalits, it doesn't matter. So, but what was one interesting thing was, because I said in 2014, when you speak to Dalits, and I said, how come you're, I said, did you vote for the BJP in 2014? He said, yes. And I think, but what came out was that, I said, what are you going to do this time? He said, I'm with the BSP and we are with the Gathbandhan. And, and I said, what happened in 2014? So he said, because we felt that we wanted to be part of the Hindu, vote.
Counted as a Hindu
vote. As a Hindu vote. Mm. But he said, you come out of the polling booth and they say, acha, hathi koi diya hoga. So he says, there's nothing that's going to break me, take me away from this thing. They're going to look at me as an outsider. So I've decided I'm just going to be with the Gathbandhan.
What were the issues that you felt in both the states? Like, what were the key things that you felt people were thinking about before voting? In the people that you spoke to, of course, you can't speak for the states, but what were the things that you found?
So I mentioned that in Gujarat, from rural to urban, urban to rural, there was a strong contrast, and livelihood, crop prices was an issue. That way, I do think this will, if opposition does not do well at all and BJP does as well as the numbers are showing right now, it will be a big question that statistically we are at a point right now where rural wages are growing very slowly. Modi government has tried very strongly to prevent high inflation, food inflation. The consequence of that has been that people have not been able to get good prices for their crops. So what has gone missing, despite these two very strong factors going on, why has that not been translated into any political results? That's one thing. In Jharkhand, in contrast, in rural areas, a big issue going on is land acquisition. That there is a sense so Jharkhand got its first majority government under the BJP in 2014. Soon after the Lok Sabha elections, BJP formed the first majority government. And the Raghubar Das-led government has led a few quick moves to change the way land can be acquired. They're trying to make it simpler, easier. Jharkhand has more than 30% people below poverty line. A lot of them directly depend on land. So there is a bit of fear and anxiety after he tried to make those changes that we are going to lose this land. So in rural areas, that land acquisition, especially in Adivasi constituencies, 5 constituencies I think reserved for scheduled tribes, that land acquisition, forest rights issue was definitely a big concern in Jharkhand. Urban areas, for sure, again, there was love for how Modi dresses, how he conducts himself in foreign countries, that he's increased India's prestige, Pakistan, all of these issues, especially among young people. I think there was a lot of popularity over these nationalism questions and all his, you
know, like Balakot, did like Balakot or surgical strikes, were these like, I'm curious because in Delhi we hear so much, like when we're consuming the media, we're only hearing about his muscular.
Are you talking this about in Gujarat?
No, in Jharkhand as well, I saw this, and Gujarat too, I can come to it.
I was curious because that's the one talking point in cities in Delhi that you hear, that he's given it back to Pakistan and all that. How has that translated? Like, have people in other parts also, I mean, is this a talking point, his policy with Pakistan or surgical strikes?
So, I can give a couple of examples. In Rajkot, I think there was a little bit skepticism among Patel farmers on what was done or not really achieved in Pakistan. But still, people, I think, appreciated the chutzpa or so on. Amreli has had a lot of distress. It's one of the biggest cotton-growing regions. And there, people were saying that if they had not done this Pakistan thing, people would have probably beaten up BJP workers if they had come to the villages. This has become a face-saving thing that at least we'd kept up national prestige. Okay. And in Jharkhand, I did hear a lot of this Pakistan and Balakot sort of strike thing, even in areas like Goda. One of my last reports from there, there's a land acquisition, there's water stress, but younger people were saying, but still he's done fine in when it comes to, there people were saying, we expect this party will not do well in state elections, which are later this year, but for national reasons, he's still done,
So it does well seem like... So it does seem like at least the trends now are saying 345 NDA and 91 UPA and 106 others. So Congress has picked up a bit. NDA is still, of course, very, very strong. So it does seem like, from what the two of you are saying, is that Modi was, I mean, not with you, but at least with you, it seems like nationally people looked at Modi as an alternative. And maybe
yes, for sure, that we like his way of speaking. Someone was telling me that he really enjoys listening to Modi's speeches. In Jharkhand, someone was telling me, and then I asked them, okay, then what do you think of Babulal Marandi's speeches or Hemant Soren's speeches? And he's like, I haven't really even heard them or so on.
Really?
So I think that nationalism narrative and the fact, the kind of play they have got on media and in newspapers and all have definitely,
that's,
I think, played a role.
That's something interesting, actually. I'd like to come to the role of media. Uttar Pradesh has, like, Dainik Jagran, the most read paper, very, very, it's quite openly pro-BJP and all that. But what is your assessment of how we've seen a very, very friendly media since 2014 when it comes to Modi? Literally everything he does is sort of
blown up. Mail.
Do people care? Do people watch television or watch news? Does it affect them in any way? Or are we thinking we're too important?
No, it's not a question of the media being important. It's about the narrative that is constantly bombarded to you. Mm. And there's no counter-narrative. And so every time you keep saying that he's the best, there's nobody kind of challenging that. Nobody's ever questioning it. Nobody's even telling you what are the pitfalls of, what are their gains? I mean, what have they done, what they have not done? There's no counter-narrative. So funny, but if you go to and you ask people, do you have a job? No. Do you have you got any of the benefits that they roll out? No. Who will you vote for? Modi. So it's almost as if they are like, hypnotized by this, because there's nobody else. They're not able to think otherwise, because this constant bombardment of the, and that's not just the media, it's also the BJP themselves.
Yeah. So UP, they have a formidable system with booth workers.
Absolutely.
Tell us a bit about, like, what did you find out when it comes to their strategy of social media or volunteers? Just explain the BJP machinery to us a bit.
I mean, in fact, last time for the Rajasthan elections, for instance, when I'd gone to Bhiwani, just outside Delhi. So what they do is that, they have big data, big money, big resources, and a big workforce. Now, that is something, is that what the future is? Because, which means that if you don't have any of this, are you just going to kind of roll over and get crushed? Because, for instance, I mean, they come with this booth, the Panna Pramukhs who have this, the voter list, they mobilize, they get there, get people to move out. Then the other, I mean, I don't know how true they are, but there were these reports coming from journalists in Lucknow post the election that, for instance, when the last day of polling, BSP workers, SP workers were given the red card, which means that you can't go out by the police. So you're literally stopping people from going to the booth.
Okay.
So there's also this kind of, it's not that they're just only doing their stuff, they're also trying to stop other people from working, other party workers. So all of that put together, is that good for democracy? Is that the way forward? I mean, these are the questions. So, if you talk about the BJP's election machinery, you can't beat it, because by sheer, like I said, the resources that they have.
What was your assessment of media's role in wherever you went? Like, were people reading news, watching news and being influenced by it, or being, and what is the news coverage like in a place like Gujarat or Jharkhand? How are the regional papers and channels poised?
So I think there have been some analysis which have shown that most media is very upper caste dominated, that more than 90% senior editors everywhere are upper caste.
Yeah, so
CSDS did do a survey which I think mathematically also shows more than 90%. Yeah. And I think somewhere one does see that sort of reflection in perhaps it's both caste as well as ownership. A lot of these newspapers own mining industry, they own other, like, their commercial interests, caste interests coincide so much. That does show in the kind of coverage that they are giving to the government, that instead of asking any questions, it's very, very adulatory. It's like, rose petals, wala photo and all of that. So, and in contrast to how they deride opposition leaders and all, I did see in newspapers, Hindi newspapers in Ranchi, in Ahmedabad, Ahmedabad, I found the farmers quite sharp though in their analysis. I even included this in one of the stories where one farmer saying that all you need to be popular here is to be a bold bachchan. That you have to be really savvy with your words and so on, and that Modi does have that skill. That he's trying to, you know, he's speaking in a way which is really connecting with people, or so. And I think media has definitely added to that in how they've.
But did you meet like voters who like told you, okay, we read this in the paper and that's why we think he's good, or we saw this in the news and that's why, for Modi and against Congress also? Because sometimes you also hear, at least in Delhi, you hear ki wo dekho Rahul Gandhi ne kya bola tha us din speech mein, kaise usko vote de sakte hain, you know. So because of the lot of derision that he faces on television or social media, people do have this perception that he's like,
in particular how they perceive opposition and how they're being portrayed. Not so strongly, at least not in Jharkhand and so on. What I did think was that the only places where I saw people's opinion differing from what the dominant narrative is, where there are certain other organizations on the ground. It may not be just a political party. It may be, say, Jharkhand, for example, has a lot of informal alliances of people resisting land acquisition. So in those areas, despite this newspaper coverage and TV coverage that they get, there was a strong anti-BJP vote or sentiment, which maybe we'll see at least in the Adivasi constituencies. So in Jharkhand, there has been a movement called this Pathalgadi movement, erected these megaliths. They wrote constitutional provisions. So this was going on in 1718, that they put down constitutional provisions on the these megaliths, saying that people, outsiders should not enter these Adivasi areas, which is just in general showing the anxiety around land acquisition, and they are about to lose their livelihood. So in those areas, because the coverage was so anti-Adivasi and anti-farmers, a year or so back, they started boycotting three Hindi newspapers. We think these people are constantly showing us as if we are some terrorists or militants or so on in the kind of action we are taking. So there I felt that because maybe their Granth Sabha organization or so on, they're so strong, that there was a bit of a counter despite this very dominant narrative which we see in TV and this thing, but not
I
so
think
much
in
other
the South
places.
For instance, like all these political parties have their own television channels, like the DNC.
Well, yeah, like in, yeah,
which DNC. I think, which has not happened in the North, none of them.
Well, I mean, Punjab, I think, yeah,
but not in like UP, Bihar,
maybe.
And,
maybe,
you know,
not
which,
a political.
Would that make a difference, you think?
So, I don't know. I was even thinking, say, cooperatives, trade unions, you know, when we are going on speaking of livelihood issues and job issues and all. Somewhere I felt that the whole time I've been reading this, unemployment has increased and all, and I do report on labor issues. And I was not so sure it will become a political issue or a voter issue, because for the last 30 years, we've seen the government very divorced from what goes on in workplaces. There is no regulation. There is just no this thing at all. So for people to make that connection that, oh, there's 3% more unemployment, my work conditions are bad, my wages are worse, so it's this particular government responsible, I'm not sure about that. And from Indira Gandhi's time onwards itself, the state has completely retreated from workplaces and regulating workplaces. And the second issue is that...
That's a very interesting point, and I've heard that from a lot of other people also who've travelled, like in Maharashtra, reporters who said that, yeah, there is a dissatisfaction because of unemployment, and there is a feeling that people feel, okay, Modi hasn't delivered. But they're like, not like before this we were...
Yeah,
you
employment
know, like,
has not been coming from the state anyway.
So people are also like, okay, 5 years all...
And one thing that I would, I think maybe it should be done, is that you have at least 10 or more, I don't know, like more than 10 crore people who migrate, who do not have voting rights where they're working. Yes. In Surat, you would have lakhs of these workers. So when we are talking of livelihood and job issues, when crores and crores people don't have voting rights where they live and work, I don't know if that will really show up.
In fact, that's one of the things against the BJP, which, I mean, conspiracy theories, that, you know, that they've taken out a lot of people from the voters list.
There were these things that were said.
But to go back to what you were saying on the media, I mean, whether it was WhatsApp or this new, let's remember that the people, Indians are very politically aware, especially in North India, especially in UP, Bihar, because politics gives them things. You know, it's an access to education, to jobs, to stuff like that, because who you are aligned to, it's literally a question of life and death, who you're aligned to. So if you're with the BSP, you know you're going to get certain things if the BSP comes to power. So in that sense, they're very, very aware. You don't need newspapers and... but there's a whole new generation of voters who are kind of getting their information from WhatsApp, etc. And how have they voted? It would be interesting to see how they voted this time.
Yeah, and when it comes to media, there's also the counter sort of thing here that apart from Modi, of course, Modi is, it's not just the media, he plays at different levels, but like someone like Atishi got a lot of media attention, someone like Kanhaiya got a lot of media attention, and both of them are trailing in their seats, they're not really. So it's also true that I guess it can't only be media, because among the new ones, I think Atishi got a lot of, like for a regional player, first timer, she got a lot of attention. Yeah, and her campaign was covered, you know, nice and proper. People went on her trail. Kanhaiya also, I think everyone was super interested.
Maybe they're going to vote differently in the state assembly, and
that is,
perhaps.
That is what people, I mean, at least from what we also...
That's how it's shown so far, that they always vote differently for the national election and different for the state.
Yeah.
So maybe they'll get Kanhaiya and Atishi for the state, who knows?
Okay, so question on the opposition. Do you guys, like Yogendra Yadav, believe that Congress should die?
No.
What is your... I mean, okay, if...
No, the thing
globally
is that...
Globally, our trends are still there. UP is still at 91, NDA is still at 343. It does seem like if they don't cross the 100 mark, I mean, if Congress doesn't... Their internal assessment said 134.
Oh, no, no chance.
So if that's not happening...
No, no, that was not happening from the beginning.
Okay. But where do you think they got it so horribly wrong?
Congress?
They still haven't been able to revise...
It's because they don't have a new narrative, you know. They don't, you have to reinvent yourself as a party that is ready to take on the BJP in terms of, not by becoming more Hindu, you know, by being a temple goer, and use that as imagery, if at all. But you, do you have a plan? What, how are you going to count? What's your, I mean, what is your counter to the 2,000 rupees? To be fair, Modi in this campaign did not use any of his development issues to campaign. He was only talking about nationalism. He was talking about, he didn't use any of that.
2014 was all about jobs. This time was more about, I have secured India.
Yeah. And which actually didn't resonate, at least in UP, because it was really about, you know, whether I'm going to get my, what are you giving, you know, each community and caste. But in terms of the Congress, yeah, so what were you countering it? So it was like an almost like an issueless election, which is where the BJP scored. Because there was no issues to counter them. He was not talking about development. No, he was not talking about demonetization. Neither did the Congress talk about it. So what were you talking about? He was talking about Rafael. Modi was talking about... and nationalism.
Yeah,
so,
and
you know, I mean,
striking.
It was just one of those issueless...
I do think Rafael didn't stick at all.
No.
I don't know what you guys feel
not
about
at all.
I mean, even as a journalist, I felt that the story was, A, it was not a simple story to, you know,
see, it would have...
Or to make people...
Sorry.
So, to me, like, yeah, the whole Rafael...
See, Rafael, you can't... unless Rahul Gandhi thinks that, you know, what, how Bofors worked, that Rafael is going to work, or how CAG worked in 2014.
Yeah, yeah.
But unfortunately, what happens is that the mood has to be right for something like this to click. So obviously people were not so anti-Modi yet for Rafael to stick. See, that's when you throw mud, it sticks. But in a kind of a fluid situation where they felt that, look, let's give him another chance. That was also true, huh, by the way, when you kept hearing.
Yeah.
Is that...
Ki, abhi 5 saal hua, ek aur 5 saal dekhte hain.
Because, I mean, you know, because he used that 70 years... quite, you know, pretty well, that, you know, these guys have been around for 70 years. And to be fair to the people in Uttar Pradesh, you've seen Mayawati and the BSP for the last 20 years. You've seen Mulayam Singh Yadav and Kanchiram for the last 30 years, sorry. Mulayam Singh Yadav and the Samajwadi Party for the last, since the early 90s. So, hey, let's give this guy a chance, you know.
That's true. I think that is... Yeah, a lot of people, and which is fair also, because I think the Indian voter is very patient also. Like most people, you're like, "Theek hai, nahi hua, par dekh lete hain, try kar lete hain."
Well, they gave UPA two terms in 2004 and 2009.
So even though like a lot of people would be upset with Modi, there was always this sentiment, okay, let's try. What do you think, where do you think the opposition, Congress, not the opposition, but principal opposition, failed? What were, I mean, it's pretty obvious they're failing right now. where do you think they...
So I do think that there is a issue there where they are, when we, the way we on, like on Twitter or Delhi or so on, the discussions like BJP is communal, Congress is not. I don't find that that resonating with people, they don't necessarily see this as this is a communal party and this is not. Mm-hmm. I don't know, is it that we are all, like in general, everybody's a little communal, so they don't see it. Overall, Congress has also been communal in the past, or it's a predominantly upper caste dominated party, or... And I'm definitely critical of how they've responded with this, we'll go to temples and all that. If they stand for something else, then they are definitely not putting it forward strongly. Whatever their version of secularism is or human rights is or so on, they do not put forward it very strongly. Maybe they mention something in their manifesto which does not reach people.
This communal secular thing is not something that people really...
I think first, like, Congress itself doesn't seem so convinced about it, right? They think at heart we are good people, but let's not make a big show about it in case it turns off some people, yeah. Right? That their feedback from their understanding from the last election is that we are putting off Hindus. You need to examine, like, what's your own thinking, you know? Why is it even...
They're very
confused. Your principles are clear, why is it confusing you so much?
Which is why they have to reinvent.
Just stand for what you believe in. Are you sure what you... Are you even clear what you believe in?
Yeah, very recently in Bhopal, I think Digvijay held a 1 kilometer rally with Naga Sadhus, with that computer Baba, and it was like a sea of saffron, and he said that, okay, no one has a monopoly over saffron. So I think he tried to play a little bit of, you know, Hindutva, but then I guess you can't beat a Sadhvi Pragya at it, or a BJP at it, because it's just, it's their forte, you know.
You're starting to contest on those terms, right?
No, they have to reinvent themselves.
Which is why, I guess, like you said, but that's interesting that this communal secular thing is maybe just something that we guys talk a lot about in Delhi, but a regular voter is maybe not really looking at things that way, but not for the minorities.
Yes, for sure. I think unless you have a clear reason that you see some concern from the RSS ideology, then there was a clear anti-BJP thing, whether you're an Adivasi, whether maybe you're a religious minority, they are sensitive to this, that this party represents an ideology which may not, which does not treat us as equal, but among no one else does one find it. Okay. I did find some young Muslim voters in Lohardaga who were saying that, he was a painter, he was saying that my work has been fine since they came because, you know, all this painting signs on Swachh Bharat and all has given me great work. Mm. And so maybe he may be okay. There I found some contradictions also among the younger people that they may be thinking differently from how their families think. Mm.
Interesting.
No, this communal secular thing, what you're saying, sure, it has been whipped up a lot by the so-called secular side, and they're not convincing because, like she said, that they themselves are not convinced about their own secularism. So, you know, they always hunt for the hound and run with the hare. I mean, like Digvijay, you were saying, he's been braying for the last 10 years that I was the first one to get cow protection in Madhya Pradesh when I was chief minister.
And Kamal Nath invoking NSA for cow slaughter.
So, you know, in that sense, so it falls flat. Mm. But there is a real danger to secularism in that sense, what this party represents and what the RSS represents. So how does that fight carry on? Mm. Who's going to carry out that fight? It's certainly not the Congress, it seems.
What about the regional players? Like, was Akhilesh, I mean, Gathbandhan must be a huge factor. And in fact, what you heard mostly from reporters was that it's going to give BJP a tough fight. But now it seems like it's not.
I don't know what the figures are coming out now.
Actually, what are the Uttar Pradesh figures? Yeah, does anybody have? I'm trying to look.
Is it respectable? Is it a respectable loss or?
Well, let me see. I can't really see. So the overall it's 344, but why can't we see Uttar Pradesh?
Well, we can go to the other regional parties. So talking about the Congress is wherever the Congress is pitted against the BJP, it has just been steamrolled. It has just kind of, you know, I mean, literally rolled over and died. I mean, whether it's Rajasthan, Madhya Pradesh, Maharashtra, except for Punjab.
Oh, Neha's here.
So,
finish.
Yeah. So the thing is that in terms of the regional parties, one thought that Mamata would kind of give the BJP a good fight. It hasn't happened. I don't know what the figures are yet. TDP.
So right now, 12:31 updates I'm reading from Economic Times is BJP 58 and Mahagathbandhan 21. That's a shocker. No, yeah, I mean, that could go true against what a lot of reporters were at least saying. But does this mean that Modi has trumped caste? He's like, he's above caste calculations?
I'm not sure, because one has to know what happened there. Because like I said, there's, you know, after all, there has been all these stories about, you know, a bit of rigging.
But none of them are substantiated, I think. I mean,
not about the EVMs, about people not being allowed to vote, the voter list not being there. Maybe there's a different way of looking at it. You know, but the BSP, SP workers not allowed to kind of get to their booths. So who knows?
Welcome, Neha. We were just discussing Uttar Pradesh's numbers, where BJP seems to be leading with 58. Right. It's still just trends. Yeah. But tell us a bit. Okay, so you traveled to Madhya Pradesh and Uttar Pradesh also.
Yes.
So we had a long chat about what these guys felt the issues were, what was resonating with the voters. So just give us a little bit of insight of what you found in UP and MP. What were the key sort of issues that people were thinking about while voting, and the Modi factor? Like, did you overwhelmingly meet people who said we're voting for a PM this time, and in that way is this election more about Modi than issues?
So I traveled to MP, UP and Bihar. In Bihar, most of the places where I was, in Ara, in Bhojpur and in Jahanabad, all these places, there was a lot of resentment against a lot of things that have happened in the last 5 years, especially when it comes to, say, the socio-economic situations on the ground. For example, the unemployment, demonetization, GST, all of that. But towards the end, each time I would meet somebody, they would say, yeah, ye hua, ye hua, ye hua. But towards the end, they would say, magar Pakistan mein jaake bum to giraya. That is something that I heard a lot in Bihar. Okay. I didn't hear the same thing in UP and MP. And especially in the tribal pockets in MP. I didn't hear that at all. But looking at the numbers, the trends till now, what is definitely very clear to me now is that while there was a lot of resentment on the ground, say for instance in Western UP, there's a growing agrarian crisis in the sugarcane belt. The farmers haven't been paid for the last 2 years in spite of the High Court judgment, and people are really struggling. And in areas like Baghpat, which were supposed to be really productive areas for farming, we've seen cases of farmer suicides that was unheard of. Similarly, in East UP, there was a lot of resentment, especially because of demonetization, number of national security, the arrest 120 arrest under the National Security Act, all of that. But it seems to me that while in those areas, for instance, in East UP, when I was traveling, I saw in each and every village, there were flags of the Hindu Yuva Vaini, but there was nobody from the opposition parties, whether it's the Samajwadi Party, BSP or the Congress. And I think what it shows is that while there is resentment, the opposition parties have not been able to mobilize that resentment in the form of votes. Mm-hmm. And that is what we are seeing.
I think that's broadly what even Anumeha found from her travels, that there was no sort of a counter narrative or someone else offering them something better.
Yes.
So it just ended up. You wrote a piece for us about RSS and its various wings, boys, men, young men and old men.
Yes, yeah.
Tell us, especially in UP, tell us a bit about how RSS campaigns for the BJP, how strong it is, and vis-a-vis a Congress party's cadre.
Right.
What is the cadre strength that BJP has with RSS on board?
See, that's the thing now. I think it's more and more clear that it's not the BJP, it is the RSS that is responsible for all of this, electoral victory and whatever's happening on the ground. For instance, say in UP, like I said, it's not even RSS any longer in East UP. It's the Hindu Yuva Vaini, which has rejected RSS for not being able to fight enough for the Hindutva cause. Mm-hmm. So now it's the Hindu Yuva Vaini, they've already started renaming the public squares and the tea points, saying Yogi Adityanath Choraha, Tiraya, or something. There's several of them in Azamgarh, Barabanki, all these places. But also, at the same time, I would say that, see, Congress has never been a cadre-based party. Mm. But RSS has always had, and now, not just in UP, but we've known this Indian Express report that was published 2 years back, which said that 20 years back, there were 650 units of RSS in the Northeast. Now there are 35,000. That just shows that they've just been there, and not just with the immediate agenda in mind, but also through various diversions with the educational wing, women's wing, welfare wing, Seva Bharti, Vidya Bharti, Rashtra Sevika Samiti, Vanvasi Kalyan Ashram. They've just been there and they've stayed and they've worked. In comparison to that, all these other parties are not cadre-based party, and more so, for example, BSP was, but now in the last 4-5 years, each time something has happened, they've not been present on the ground, and which is why we saw forces like the Bhim Army come up in Western UP, but they've also fizzled down. So that is something that needs to be taken very seriously in terms of presence on the ground. That so is not
you
there.
Didn't find such a... I'm surprised in UP, like, you didn't even find, like, SPBSP karyakartas.
So SPBSP, while on the top, they did this caste arithmetic and came together. But we have to see that SP and BSP,
they
don't like each other. And there's a clear class kind of situation here, because SP has more OBC population, which are landowners, and BSP caters to the Dalits who are landless. And there's always a kind of a situation between conflict between them. So till the time that doesn't happen, I don't think this kind of alliance will work. This is a lesson.
That only once the vote share comes.
Yes. Yeah.
Okay, so one question, like, there is a lot of criticism of the Modi government when it comes to maybe media, using the media, money power, muscle power. But I want to know, like, what are the things that worked for him in earnest, in terms of, did you meet voters who said, okay, this scheme really helped us, this money came into our account, and this really... So I want to know, like, there has to be some sort of groundwork that he did that really worked for BJP. What were those schemes?
Houses, because there were, I met 2-3 farmers who got their houses done.
This is the Awas Yojana.
Yeah.
But which they've only renamed, right?
Yeah.
But they've done a good job of delivering that.
I'm not sure whether they've done a good job, but there were some who got it. It's not that, you know, it goes in a very nice, proper manner. It seemed a bit erratic, who got it and who didn't. Then the Ujwala, the gas. Mm. But again, you know that they can't afford to get the second gas cylinder. Mm. But I think what he's done, then the other thing was, there was Ujwala, there was
electricity,
the power. Mm. A lot of people talked a lot about the power. That, mm, you know, they were getting, instead of 3 hours and 4 hours, they were now getting for 18 hours,
okay,
19 hours.
So that's a big improvement.
Huge improvement, but apparently that a lot of that was already done in UPA.
Okay.
But what he's done is that, what works in favor of Modi is that he looks as if, I have given it to you. Mm. That's where the narrative comes in. Mm. You know, it's not the state government, it's not anybody else, but it's Modi straight to the people. Mm. In fact, one of the BJP leaders, when demonetization had happened, he said that it was really about Modi suddenly being made to be aware to the last citizen in this country, because everybody was affected. Mm. So in that sense, what worked for him is that this whole persona and this whole myth that is created, that I have given it to you, you are beholden to me, you know, it's that kind of a relationship. There's no government and there's no bureaucrat and there's no nothing in between.
Okay. What about you? What schemes did you find working for him in his favor?
So in Gujarat, I did not find such a strong pattern of anything almost. There it was more this regionalism narrative and the general narrative of communalism and other things. And in fact, there was more dissatisfaction, at least in what's going on with farm prices and so on. In Jharkhand, I did notice, and I was there in December as well, I think this government, the way they crack down from the top, it's different from the previous government, that the kind of instructions that are issued that by December, this should have reached this village, and there will be a video conference in which you will be asked, did it reach or not? Hmm. Whether it's toilets, whether it's electric poles, whether it is the gas thing, or PM Awas. There are several problems in several of these schemes. There are gaps. There's, you know, your pension amount is lower than your gas cost, so you obviously cannot refill it and so on. And PM Awas too, there are stipulations which people find difficult to fulfill, the kind of things that need to be done. And some people felt it's actually benefiting more just the building material supplier and so on. But just the way the delivery is definitely, you know, whether it is related to a certain authoritarian style or so on. And we also saw the same in when Aadhaar was being implemented. That's again one thing where I think the opposition had some scope to build on the dissatisfaction that had been created through the disruption of schemes. Mm. That even where people were getting ration and pension, it has been disrupted for lakhs of people when they tried to overnight make it mandatory. Which was this, you know, this was, I mean, you can say it's this government skill that they wanted to just go ahead with it. They've managed to go faster with it. But the opposition, on the other hand, could have said that you've disrupted so much. You've disrupted basic services for the most vulnerable. They were not able to for various reasons that we've been discussing. And in terms of delivery, there's definitely a difference in how they, you know, they are given very strict deadlines that before, 4 months before elections, this should have reached, that should have reached, and so on.
So there's like a fast sort
of
a way.
I forgot to put toilets, which was the most important.
Okay. Yeah, people did speak a lot about toilets.
That was a big, huge thing out there.
And Swachh Bharat, like, is Swachh Bharat something that people talk about? Do they feel like, okay, this is something good he's doing?
No, they don't follow it themselves. I mean, that doesn't work at all.
What about
you? There's still garbage and everything everywhere.
One part, I did a story on the midday meal workers in Bihar, and I went to some 68 schools. So the first thing was that there are like 30 lakh midday meal workers, all of them women, and mostly Dalits and widows and from the marginalized castes, but they paid 37 rupees per day to cook for 400 students. Mm-hmm. So now one thing is Ujwala reaching people's houses and people getting gas. But this is women cooking in schools for 400 students on chulha because the school is not providing the money to refill it. Mm-hmm. So it's like another level. This whole thing of, you know, women in a patriarchal framework, women getting access to gas, but within schools that are under the state and central government, the primary schools and the higher secondary schools, within those schools there is in 68 schools I didn't find anything, so honestly speaking. And all of those women within in their houses also, they did not, except out of those 68, only one school that I visited had a gas connection. So that just says that, you know, even the schools not having enough money, is the government not serious about it. So that is a big thing. Apart from that, while electrification is concerned, all the villages that I went to, Jabua, where there's a major problem in terms of sickle cell anemia, that all of that is not covered under Ayushman Bharat. They can't. So if you bang your head against a wall and if you there's a head injury, that is not covered under Ayushman Bharat. So some serious lapses, and there have been cases of deaths and not being taken into account under the scheme, which is Ayushman Bharat. But also at the same time, I went lots of villages that I visited in Jabua and in the areas around Indore. The electricity, there are poles, but there's no electricity. Similarly, in Bundelkhand, while there is electricity, there have been electricity connections, but the monthly bills have been as high as 20,000, 30,000 for farmers in rural areas. And this is, Bundelkhand is one of the most impoverished areas. So that is the reason why people don't use it and they've stopped paying and stuff. So.
But did you find anything working for him? Like, were there some schemes that people talked about and said, okay, he did this and we like him for this?
I mean, in the sense that, if you can say working in the sense that the first set of gas cylinders reached. But what happened in the second round? Similarly for the toilets. A lot of toilets that I found, some newer ones have been constructed. There is again a caste divide. So if the upper caste sarpanch has given money to certain people from certain castes, but not the other ones. Some of the toilets that were already there were repainted and shown to be this. Then there are dry toilets that are still, people from certain communities are expected to come and clean. So that is not functional. The other thing, I don't know if it's a very right thing to say, but a lot of, we have to, I'm not justifying it, I'm just putting it out in the public domain, that a lot of women, this whole thing of, especially in rural areas, that is the only time they get to go out and talk to people, talk to fellow women in the rural areas. So that is also one of the reasons why, you know, that this, even when the toilets have been constructed, they're not functional and...
Because they prefer going out.
I'm saying about women, apparently this, for the first time, women have voted as much as men this election. And apparently they've all... Apparently, that has worked in favor of Modi.
Yeah.
And whether this, whether the women is his new vote bank. I think
what would also be interesting, I mean, there's a lot of talk of it in the media, but I really don't know if we could substantiate it, or even if there would be numbers that come out to tell us about Muslim women voters and whether triple talaq really
Triple talaq was not work. It didn't matter there.
I mean, I wonder if Muslim women felt that this was... But
because there's not a single case that's come. Nobody's complained yet. There's not a single case.
No, but banning it, abolishing it, I'm wondering if that worked in his favor in any way. Though, I don't think we'll ever have any proof of that. I don't even think data would sort of give us such minute data.
Because there was a time, there was some research that showed that women earlier never went towards a kind of a more authoritarian kind of party. They always voted for a far more easy liberal kind of party. But if this time the women have come out as much as men, I think there's a story there. We don't know what it is, but whether they have helped Modi, I'm not sure.
I think the thing is also with women voters, I mean, the traditional understanding is that they vote along with the family, like what the head of the family says. And
no, but I think Pranoy Roy's book has kind of burst
that
myth.
I mean, he says it's changing a bit now. They have their own, and they have their own sort of, which is why like a lot of the campaign songs in Bihar now appeal to the bhaji and the, you know, the bhaji.
And a lot of his schemes are appealing to the women, whether it's toilets, whether it's gas cylinder.
Yeah, why I asked you that question is because I would be a little skeptical of a narrative that says, okay, this is just a vote based on his nationalist or a sort of a Hindutva sort of a pitch. I mean, I would like to know if development or schemes played some role in people wanting to vote for him.
Like we all said, yes, it did. Hmm. All these schemes did.
Yeah, which is why I wanted to know if something, if there were schemes that people decided that, you know, it's going to
work. For sure they did, because these things were being discussed.
We were talking about media before this, so, and maybe we should ask you also this, because you've traveled in three states. What do you think, how would you assess the media's role? Are people, do people care about what's written in papers? Do they watch it? Does it influence them in any way? Or... you don't think, or do you think it's just not relevant?
No, I think what has happened is that the mainstream media has lost its credibility so much that we have created, we had in 2014 elections, we had WhatsApp, now we have WhatsApp University, that's the difference. Mm-hmm. And that is the only thing that is played on the ground with, in the 2014 elections, the technology penetration, especially the internet, was not as much as it is now. Mm-hmm. And that has played, so a lot of people just rely not just on what the stuff that comes on WhatsApp groups, but also it is sent by people they know. And that is the reason why they trust that more than what is shown in the media, which is anyway not talking about the things that it should be talking about.
Okay. And so you are saying that WhatsApp and social media news that people are getting is way more important than what they sort of...
People pay more attention to it now. For example, in a lot of two-tier cities, I know that a lot of young people who are now accessing internet in their own languages and not English, but their own local languages, they have that cheap Chinese smartphone and an internet package that makes it easy to access Facebook and WhatsApp. Those are the two things that they access. And that is where all the source of like entertainment, information, communication, everything happens on that. And that is something that needs attention. Also, we need to understand that we need to not forget that 2014 elections, just before, and I keep coming back to this, that the Muzaffarnagar riots happened because a fake video was circulated.
Yes.
And from that point to now, it has just been an epidemic and we have not been able to deal with that.
May I ask you a question? Since you were in Muzaffarnagar, like when I was there this time in 2019, so one of the people told me, a social activist, that if that fake video and if whatever happened and transpired, if the state administration had actually looked at it as a law and order problem, which was Akhilesh's government, picked up the guys who were responsible for it, and finished the situation, contained it right there and then, would it have kind of, or did Akhilesh and his government actually allow this thing to kind of, because it suits them this polarization?
No, I absolutely right, because it's not just this party that plays on this fear, but there are other parties also that play on the similar fear created by polarization, and we'll have to acknowledge this if we want to move forward. Mm-hmm. Same happened with the Akhilesh government. Mm-hmm. They were lapses. They did not do things that could have been controlled at that point. And that was the reason why BJP won 71 seats and came to power from 12 to 71, and now we're dealing with it.
Okay, my last question to you guys is about women voters. Mm-hmm. If you did meet women voters, what were the issues that they sort of... did you see any differences when it came to men or was it the same, or what were the sort of issues that you felt women were concerned about this election?
Well, in rural India, I mean, Uttar Pradesh, you know, it was, they're not terribly forthcoming.
Mm.
So, apart from that, no, the thing is that they were really, like I said, I think it was a caste-pitched battle in Uttar Pradesh. I mean, it was not about, really about getting the gas cylinder, because that is also few and far between. Yet, it made an impression, for sure. But the fact is, I still need to know whether caste played a role for, I mean, if Modi was able to overcome caste, we'll only know whether...
I think UP is something everyone would really want to watch and see what happened.
Whether only the vote percentage will tell us whether he's been able to do it.
Mm.
So, about women voters, I think a lot of times I found that there were other, like, you know, whatever was going on with the rest of the family and village, they were also speaking of similar issues. I think one issue which any opposition could have built on and could have resonated strongly with women would have been water.
Hmm.
There is a huge water crisis. It's completely falling on women's head and girls' head to get water, to, you know, women are going to wells at midnight and like peak afternoon, doing multiple trips. And there's a water deficit and water stress situation across the country, in several districts of the country, whether it was in the western Gujarat or in Jharkhand. So not that there was any political discussion or debate on water at all, but it's shocking. Your water levels are at 640 feet below the ground, or in other, like Saurashtra coast, they're saying it's falling by 10 feet every year. In Jharkhand, farmers were telling me, women farmers are also saying it's falling by 5 to 6 feet.
It's amazing, and you don't hear this in any of the election reporting.
I don't know how everybody just glossed over it.
Just,
I think
not
reporters
issues
did bring it up, but I don't think there was any political discussion, any... maybe it was mentioned
in
a few manifestos
or so
on.
Because local issues really don't play in a national
election. Maybe.
I think water has now reached a state where it would you would be able to speak to people. It's such a universal phenomena that's what's going on right now, that people are spending so much time dealing with the water crisis.
And they're the ones who suffer the most, and yet it doesn't matter to them.
When it comes to reporting, as maybe, like, at least for Lok Sabha, it's just personalities are more exciting to cover than...
Actually, we are moving towards like a presidential style of election more and more. We've been talking about it since 2009 when Advani started this. But it's a parliamentary democracy. People should be talking about their candidates in their constituencies.
There
there
and
is
you
nothing
would sometimes
of that
meet
sort.
A lot of
but
people
you know,
don't know.
Even the voters are not talking about it's not because we are not chasing that story.
Yeah.
They're just not looking at those issues.
But maybe that's where the opposition should have come in, right?
Mm-hmm.
That could have been one of the issues you could have built a narrative on, say water or natural resources, where they've just not been able to, you know,
so
there's
always
a wishy-washy.
It's always like, you know, Indira Gandhi, or it's always, you know, Sonia Gandhi. You know, it began with that, and I think that is what is, in a sense, corrupted. Even look at our municipal elections. I mean, look at Delhi. Does anybody care who comes to the municipality in the so-called residential colonies, even though you may not have water, you may not have your civic, bodies working, still it's only affects, I don't know, when it comes to elections, everybody's looking at people rather than issues.
What about you? What are the issues that you felt women...
So this time, I don't know, of course it's insignificant in the larger scheme of things, but this time was the first time when we had five transgendered candidates contesting, and since 2014, you know, since the election commission, the Supreme Court gave them the third gender candidate. So I went and covered the campaign of this candidate in Allahabad. Her name is Bhavani Ma, and it's kind of interesting because she's a Dalit transgendered woman and she's the Mahamandaleshwar of some akhada. So it was interesting. So that... those things, you know, when we talk about people and in a presidential style of election, these small nuances, which are so important and has such a large constituency, they get ignored and we don't talk about it. But with women again, these 3 lakh midday meal workers in Delhi, when you were talking about women voting independently from what the patriarch of the family is telling them about, they said that in these elections, if they will vote for whoever gives them a minimum wage, does not call them volunteers but calls them workers, gives them a salary, not an honorarium, and
that's
they will
very like
Yeah. So that's one of the groups where Modi had to quickly intervene, right? In October, he said he'll double the...
So he did that for the Anganwadi workers. But the midday meal workers don't even exist because they're completely from the marginalized sections. And in fact, the Anganwadi workers and the Asha workers have a big role in mobilizing in within their booths. So they're booth mobilizers, and which is why Modi felt the need to intervene, but not with these cooks. So these cooks said that we have 15 lakh votes in Bihar, and we will vote for whoever gives us minimum wage and gives us like a permanent job. So this is what I, specifically in Bihar is what I heard. So, but I don't know what has happened now.
Priyanka Gandhi has responded a little bit to this concern, no? I mean, I think I saw on Twitter also, on she's spoken a bit about the wages of teachers and midday meal workers. But again, that's one issue which we didn't hear on a national scale, where there was some scope to build on to question this government.
And
but there are large organized numbers.
And
it's a very specific charter of demands.
Like cooking is a woman's job, which she does on the side.
Great, it was lovely chatting with you guys. The latest trends are 344 for NDA. And 90 for UPA, so it's not changing much. It just seems like maybe we could, maybe they would. Last time they were 336.
Around that.
So that's a little more than last time. So it was that we can call it a tsunami, I guess.
What is the Congress tally? 53?
Congress is at 53. So they're clearly their internal projection didn't work. What they were saying, 153.
Oh.
Oh God, it's terrible. From 44, they've come to 53.
This just is 7 more.
Great. Thank you so much, guys, for watching. We have another live coming up with Atul. He'll also be speaking to some of our reporters. Do tune in. Thank you.
Thanks so much.